Welcome to a brief history of Japanese cyberpunk. I presume everyone here can read.
Yeah.
Better than the last one. Right. This is a relatively accurate and somewhat opinionated historic overview of the cyberpunk genre within Japanese visual media. First off, what is cyberpunk? And yet somehow less. Okay, now on to the fancy bullshit. I have defined it for the purposes of this as a branch of near-future speculative fiction with a focus on dystopia, social structures, and the impact of machines and man on these worlds. Other definitions are available. This one is mine. I love it. I call it George. Also, this is really self-evident. Japanese cyberpunk is written in Japan. That means it's going to have all the stuff that comes with Japan. Might sound a little bit daft, but cyberpunk is an international genre that's been done by a whole bunch of people. Great, but you can have someone typing on a typewriter in Toronto doing a masterpiece. You can have someone sitting in St. Neots as a journalist writing about the destruction of 70s England. You can have someone working in the movie scene in early 80s America trying to work out how he can rip off every episode of The Twilight Zone and turn it into a ridiculously successful movie career that gets Celine Dion into the charts. Fine, they're not in Tokyo. It's as simple as that. It's going to be very, very different for someone who's actually living in fucking Chiba. It's also worth remembering that Japanese sci-fi is a shit fest. The first recognizable Japanese sci-fi stories were the Shin Shian detective stories about robots and machines that killed people. That was their first stories was, his machine sucks, doesn't it? Then came along their amazing work. There's a fun drinking game you can play with this. Every time I absolutely bollocks up in pronunciation, you can drink along. I advise sips or you're going to die.
Well, that's called a bollocks up pronunciation. We're on a roll.
Yeah, I'm going to be taking it here, don't worry. You then had Dugu Maguri, which came out in 1935, which is probably about the first bit of protopunk they had. That was basically about a machine that comes alive and goes, oh god, this is terrible, how do I end it? It was a bit of a mix of Japanese nationalism, android terror of the Metropolis stories, and all the confusion of the cabaret of Dr. Kilgari. It was a fun little story. You've also got around, you had things like After the Wall. Godzilla turned up and showed you how science was terrible and going to kill you all. And since then, they got more depressing. So, very important culture baggage. The first stuff, we've got the first wave is the urban cowboys. It'll all make sense. This made a lot of social political comments and blew the shit out of things. It's worth mentioning, at this time, this was in the early 80s, you've got a lot of cultural baggage going on in it. Japan was extensively run as a bureaucracy at the time. That's when sci-fi was starting out. It was blending, and it had this really weird thing where it was trying to blend like the social organized cohesion of basically the Soviets and the individualism of Western free market capitalism, also known as America after it invaded and like ran the place for 6 years. And the 60s and 70s, which is what has happened before all this kicks off, was filled with student activism, political turmoil. They went through 12 prime ministers and 24 governments in a 30-year period, which is quite a rapid turnaround, a lot of change. They had a series of attempted coups and a post-war generation trying to find a place in history. This is going to create an awful lot of mixed up stuff. It's going to create a very politically charged environment. There's also a lot of the makers involved were either part of or active members of the Japanese and international punk scene and punk the new main movements, opening up a world of possibility in near futurism. They were all very looking forward. On the punk side, they were looking forward to just complete life in nihilism. On the new wave scene, they were looking forward to optimism and wearing bin liners as some kind of artistic statement. It was terrible, the haircuts were awful, but it had a big impact. Very worth remembering for this. You also had within this genre, you had extensive use of the urban deserts and hidden paradise tropes. Does anybody here belong to tvtropes.com? Or use it regularly and overanalyze everything into the ground so it's meaningless and you make life terrible?
Yes.
Any hands still up in the air?
Yeah, that's me.
Yeah, you're a bad person. Owned editors are a phenomenon that you got in an awful lot of shows at this period. We had these massive cities with several billion people in them, and you only ever saw like three of the people, probably for production values. You had an awful lot of traveling on highways, you had huge conversations going along on these massive motorways in cities that had one other car, maybe a lorry. So you basically ended up with these urban deserts with no one else going on. And you also had the Hidden Paradises, where each week they'd go and meet a new and exciting subculture that was hidden from everyone else. Basically just these hidden utopias. The fun thing with this is a lot of this came out of the Western novels, which were hugely important and massively popular in the 60s and 70s when all this fun stuff was being generated, which had a big influence on the genre. This gets even more fun when you find out that the Western novel was heavily influenced by the samurai story, because people come over in the 40s and 50s for the occupation, picked up on all the samurai stories, gone back and made huge Western blockbusters, which is great. Especially when you find out that all of those stories are bollocks. They're complete fables. The Western that we all know with the gunslinger never happened. Samurai stories, made up bullshit. There were samurais, but a lot of it's completely overhyped and basically trying to present their culture as a fun and exciting cultural fable. So you got all that going on in the genre.
It's the same as Arthurian mythology over here.
Yo, you mean invented in the 1800s by the Victorians to stop people fucking?
Yeah.
Yeah, something like that. They blew more shit up in this, so it's better. Never underestimate the power of blazing that. You also have frequently featuring biological or constructed horrors. By this, what I mean is compared to the American stuff, where you had a lot of people building, you know, their dark sci-fi, you had a lot of people building horrible little society, little place where everyone being horrible and mean to each other, like 1984, it's all just about person-on-person oppression and all that shit done. This was about, hey, we built a thing and now everyone's to eat our face! Yay! So that was their way of having a badass time. Okay. So enough of the preamble. Has everybody here got a lovely feeling of how happy and exciting all this is going to be? Kill yourself, it's quicker. Anyway. Probably the first recognisable piece of cyberpunk produced in Japan, Burst City. Very influential movie for a whole bunch of different reasons, and also really good fun if you like that kind of thing. Basically, rival gangs try to stop a power plant being built in their rundown dump, and they party like crazy. Yeah, it was fast, it was brash, it was very, very loud. It had a huge number of punk bands in it, and basically the whole thing was done by a bunch of musos. It's been recognised as having an energy few other movies in Japan had at that time. And it was just madness. They didn't necessarily know how to make a movie, or write a script, or shoot a movie, or get permission to shoot a movie, or get permission to blow up large sections of the city while shooting a movie. But they did it, and that's the important thing. And there's also... you have insane moments like when you have the rockers playing and then the Stalin literally invaded the stage and took over the instruments and then played their song, and no one knows if that was in the script or just what happened because they were all on a lot of bad speed. But yeah, punk is punk. This is a starting point for this. Hugely influential pop scenes, had huge number of albums, then ended up going into Japanese pop music and pop videos, and then eventually filtering all its way onto MTV. And people kept on going, oh, it's a visual delight and it's an exciting experiment. And the people behind me just went, yeah, we plan to do that. Oh yeah, we were pushing the paradigm. Got any more speed. It was also released a year before Cyberpunk became a thing. Which doesn't matter, but it's a funny little fact, it came out before that happened. Does anybody here know when Cyberpunk became a thing? Ah, great, I get to educate you, fuckers. The first usage of the phrase was in November 1983, issue of Amazing Science Fiction Stories. It was the first ever usage of it. It was then later used to describe a whole group of writers that were doing a bunch of disparate things, but everyone went, we need a nice little banding to market them with, and they became the Cyberpunks. And then it became my life. Anyway, following on from that, we had Akira. Hey! Who here hasn't read Akira? Fuck off! It's a huge plot, 8 volumes, something like 100 issues. It lasted about 8 years, took 8 years to make. Always amount of 2 main characters. We got Kanedo and who else?
Tetsuo!
Thank you. It's got super bikes, got biomanipulation, got giant freaking space lasers on platforms, it's great stuff. And it's got a huge number of natural disasters, many of which were kicked off by genetically engineered mutant children, playing on a whole bunch of fears that were going on at that time. It's also got, quite importantly, military's involvement and manipulation of politics as a major plot theme. As I said previously, they've had a whole series of coups that were about to kick off. So here we see the influence of the previous history coming into the genre. Of all the genre things happening in anime and manga at the time, the Cyberpunk was arguably one of the most politically charged things. Everyone else was going on about fantasy girls and romance and all that shit, and they were going, hey, remember that time the government almost got taken over by the military? Yeah. It was a good time, we all had it there. We also got late parts discussed that ended up discussing Japan's wider political place in the world. Pretty fun stuff. It's obviously also a blatant metaphor for the post-World War II generation. Read it. Especially look back to heaven. It's all good stuff. Meanwhile, in America, in 1982, Blade Runner came out. 1984, Neuromancer came out. Good fun stuff. These are generally cited as being key cyberpunk works through the international genre, in that everyone's gone and ripped them off and kept on referencing back to them and go, I'm going to do something original, I'm going to take it up page 37. That's what I think. Interestingly, both had Japan as central characters. Neuromancer had it as the center of technology, the center of economy, the center of political power. Blade Runner had it literally invading America and trying to take over. When I say character, I don't mean like literally, hello, I'm Japan, but it was there as a very present thing, it was playing on the fears of the American economy. All that leads to the slight little twist that was happening with all the stuff being made at the time, is that Japan is cyberpunk as fuck. So itself, someone sitting there in Tokyo trying to write cyberpunk is literally living in a cyberpunk city, which makes fun and interesting if you make stuff. Up next, 1985, we had Appleseed. Do people here know the basics of Appleseed?
Yeah.
Yep. Not? I'm not going to yell at you this time. He's a Borg, she isn't. They go to a city haven and then blow an awful lot of stuff up. It's in a post-apocalyptic world, it's fun, things die. Cyborgs, lots and lots and lots of guns. It's essentially a buddy series. It also doesn't. It bucked a trend at the time when you had male female characters. There was no sex in it, even though it was a mixed gender team. Mostly because he's a bot. So that killed that one. He didn't get the right implant. Oh, God. It's also the first major work of Matsune Shiro. You will hear his name in awful lot. Who got it right?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, you're going to call it out, Victor.
Yeah, right.
It also, very importantly, got the 1986
Saiyan
Award for Best Manga. It's received by a lot of people as number one representation of how well the series did, but also how popular the genre was getting. As I said, there was an awful lot of stuff also happening in the background. As soon as Akira came out, a whole bunch of copies came out. As soon as Burst City came out, there were a whole bunch of people trying to do a similar exploitation movie. On less speed, so not as good. But that award was seen as like the starting pistol, they're getting absolutely huge. Again, had politics, sociology, lots of philosophy, and lots of talking in between things blowing the fuck up. Increased usage of the tell not show element that became a hallmark of the genre, especially in mid-season when they just needed to pad it out and get a couple more episodes in. For anybody who doesn't know, the Shinji Awards, Japan's speculative fiction awards, overseen and organised by the Federation of Science Fiction Fan Groups of Japan. It was first issued out in 1970. It's basically their equivalent of the Nebula. Also similar to the Hugo Award, which means it's deeply political and corrupt as fuck, but they want it, that's the important thing. And then we had this happen. So that was Bubblegum Crisis, four women going around in mecha suits, beating Lemmy's shit out of poor little innocent murderous terrorists. Jolly good fun. Interestingly, all female protagonists, they were A, fighting killer robots, they were also going up against bureaucratic ineptitude and the tendency to go, yes, they might have slaughtered half the city, but are they bad? It also started a trend of having, in the cyberpunk genre, just having a huge number of female protagonists and quite often them going out and kicking the shit out of people before a lot of the other genres got into the idea that women can also shoot people with a gun. They had the power armor, which happened before, but this time they were along with it and had a lot of stuff back since the themes of the 60s and 70s, bureaucracy being a shit and ineptitude basically annoying. Helped popularise the exoskeleton, and it also set up AD Police, Parasite Dolls, and multiple other series. I think we're on like, we've had like three or four runs of it now. The 2040 was a bit bone, but other than that, it's all good stuff. And it's basically world builder. Then we had this happen.
Explode. Toys, a state-of-the-art adventure. Akira.
Seen that?
Yes.
Hello. This was generally recognised as the first massive adult anime hit in the Western market. Obviously, some stuff had come out before, it got big. This was done the same year as Totoro, which also did brilliantly because it's great. Although Akira did an awful lot better because it had mutants that kill people with their brains. Always a bestseller. And it was. Who here was kicking around in the 80s when anime first broke? Who here is really damn old?
Only year later.
Yeah, you know all... You remember when this was just the poster baby for everything. If you ever watch any video, UK Manga stories had this going through. It was basically the big one that broke it and got it over to this country. Similar themes as the comic, opted for a more time-scale friendly extension ending. The ending in the comic changed, but in his defense, he did actually write the ending in the comic 3 years after he did the script for this movie, so you know, you're allowed to change your mind. Although he did say that they are still canon in both cases, just slightly different canons. It was technically to be visually influential. I mean, anyone just looking over that trailer, you've seen similar stuff like that in practically everything sci-fi or even gang-related. Technical innovations. They did amazing things like record the voice first and then do the animation for the mouths, which no one else had ever even thought of doing. They decided to do it at the actual frame rate that the movie would be projected at. They decided to give people money to do the job. They decided to get someone in to help manage the whole thing. Very, very advanced stuff. If it's going too fast, please. They basically broke the whole thing. And yeah, watch it. It's awesome. And if anyone says otherwise, I will literally fight you for it. Yeah. Scene has been very cerebral, scene is asking a lot of big questions. It was basically putting the high mark on cyberpunk as a contemplative medium, which obviously means that the next thing followed up had to be the cerebral masterpiece that is this. Subtext explaining. So yeah, Dominion, Tank Police, off of the Dominion series. This was another Manami Shiro... Do I drink or not? No drink? Okay. Join this time mixing comedy and drama, unlike a lot of the other stuff. Features the police patrolling a city in tanks. I don't know why I put that part in there. in case anyone didn't get it. Interestingly enough, it had the. It actually had a couple of serious bits in it. It had environmental issues as a background device. It had, yo, questions?
Is it supposed to look like a dick?
Yes, yes. Yes. The erected caucus anti-tank weapon.
The ultimate deterrent.
What?
The ultimate deterrent.
You've seen this before.
Yes.
So that's flat packed, and then when the tank rides over it, it self-inflates and knocks the tank back. Stop laughing, this is serious. Please show us serious questions. I'll get on to that in a minute.
It was thermal plastic.
Environmental issues, you heartless fucks. Other people had done environmental issues before, obviously. I'm not going to pretend they invented the idea of everything going to hell in a handbasket. The fun thing they did, which was actually quite a new thing, was it was just a background thing. Picking up on a lot of environmentalism at the time. The basic thing was, yeah, we fucked the environment. It's gone. That happened, we can't fix it, move on, and that was quite fucked up. Was there a question? Yeah, right. It also, for a 12-year-old boy at the time, it was quite influential on me because it had done crazy cat girls in leotards. It also asked the deeply important philosophical questions, you know, what happens if you don't have a tank? These are important questions of our time. It was also quite blatantly a satire of the escalation of police force use in other countries of America, including the wonderful scene where the commissioner turns around and goes, what are you going to ask for? Nuclear weapons? And the head of the tank police goes, well, yeah, can we? just more nukes to use inside a city. And it was pretty awesome. Following that, the next Cerebral Master piece we have is from the same guy again. This is the last of the Shiro Big Three. Ironically, probably the most Western of the ones he did. Ghost in the Shell. Does everyone here know Ghost in the Shell?
Yes!
Good. This one was very deeply, traditional cyberpunk. Focusing on cybernetics, implications, people getting turned into machines. All that stuff. As I said, probably the most Western approach. It picked up the most of the stuff from the others, from what was going over on in the West. Does touch again on some of the main themes turning up. Threads danger of internal police corruption, bureaucracy, also guns and tits. Yay, guns and tits!
Yay!
Good. Ask questions about identity, use elements of simulacrum philosophy of Bouliaga, who's a Frenchman, but don't hold him against him. The original, who here knows what the original name of it was in Japan? Anyone? Right. This is a fun fact to really irritate nerds. The original translation of it is Mobile Armored Riot Police. However, that's not the name that Shiro wanted. Shiro wanted to call it Ghost in the Shell, and marketing said no. So if anyone ever goes, actually, its original name was, they're wrong. The original name is Ghost in the Shell. It's very important. Because he was cool and hip and all that. It was also second big Japanese cyberpunk smash in the West. This blew up, it was huge. The visual style and philosophical elements basically sold it huge. It had an awful lot of talking in it. Major influence in the 90s cyberpunk movies. Specifically, the Wachowski... What?
They're both transgendered now.
I'll just call them Wachowski. Did I get that name right?
Near enough.
Just in case. They've pointed out that they think the philosophy raised in this had a huge influence on the Matrix series. Especially the question of simulacra, simulation, and what is reality. In my opinion, that's like saying the movie The Descent was influenced by Plato and his cave. And yes, I'm going to take shots at the Wachowskis on this because I had to sit through Matrix 2 and 3. So, you know, they still fucking owe me on this one. Anyway, following that up, we have this little joint. If anyone else has seen this, I'll be impressed. Has anyone here seen Gunhead? Ah, you have quality class. Yeah. It's a live action Cyberpunk meets Treasure Island meets mechs meets a confusing plot and a lot of things exploding. To just give you a quick intro, 20 years in the setting of it, 20 years ago the world ran out of, I kid you not, Tex-Mexium. They had an island run by the Kyron 5 AI that made it. Then the Kyron 5 bot went all Judgment Day on everyone, so they sent in the Gunhead AI Mech, which is the gun unit heavy extermination device battalion, which called Aerobot. They never turned up in the movie. And everyone lost, so it's a draw, but something bad happened. So now scavengers are going on there. And that's the intro, and it was originally a Godzilla movie. But they thought they could make a shit ton of money off of it. It was big budget co-production, by which I mean Japan made it and they had a couple of people from America turn up in it. And then America went, we'll sell the hell out of this, because it was just at the start of the cyberpunk boom that was going on in the States. It was a 1.5 billion yen budget. In this day and age, that's like 25 million USD. At the time, that was a really major production. It was also extensively in development hell for an awful lot of time, and there were too many Kirks, and no one had a fucking clue what they were doing with it, but it is still great fun to watch. It did incredibly badly in Lost the Fortune, but then got a massive cult following. There's a little chap called James Cameron that I took a dig at in the intro, said it was his favourite B-movie ever. And that sold an awful lot of copy, and it's also so unbelievably cyberpunk as fuck that the band Frontline Assembly used it for a video in a song that's made up of Robocop 2 and Johnny Mnemonic sound bites. So if anyone ever questions its position in the canon, it's in there. It's definitely in there. So at this point, cyberpunk was picking up. It was a big genre. Everyone was like going, yay, let's get mirror shades, people kissing in the rain, it'll be great, making a whole load of money. And Japan just went, fuck that shit. We then got the second wave happening in Japan. Which wonderfully, I do not make this up, this is not my fault. The genre is called Japanese cyberpunk. So we have Japanese cyberpunk and we have Japanese cyberpunk, which is gonna get confusing. Started at the end of the 80s. Happened just as the classic styles get mainstream popularity in the States. Built on body horror and sexual elements of the first wave. We had an awful lot of constructed terror. We also had an awful lot of like tits and arse going on all over the place. So they decided to get more stuck in. Had a whole amount more surrealism and avant-garde production. Also cheapness and shock. They didn't necessarily know what they were doing, but by Christ, they were gonna do it. Whereas the previous waves were influenced by the punk and new wave movement, somewhat poke him. It's got caffeine in it, it's good for you. This was heavily influenced by the industrial music scene that was getting really big, what was going on there, and also Eraserhead and Videodrome. People who haven't seen Eraserhead.
Thank you.
So that was the trailer for something that Disney didn't make. for anyone who doesn't know the whole thing about the Razorhead, it's massively influential, as you can find out. Came out in 1977, it's a black and white fever dream with a grinding industrial noise background. It's all about that guy goes and gets married, produces that kid, whilst that woman lives in his radiator, goes around that landscape with flying sperm, intelligent invasive mold, and the man who runs the world with pipes going on. David Lynch claims it all makes sense. David Lynch says a lot of things.
It was basically
yeah, pretty much. It's brutal, it's exhausting. I mean, to actually watch it, because the soundtrack is mentally and physically exhausting. There's a lot of deeply uncomfortable sexual moments that I couldn't explain to you why they creep the living shit out of me. But yeah, when I say massively influential, I mean every single person that was involved in the Japanese subculture movement after it came out just went, yeah, we saw that, and we went, yeah, we learned one more of that. So yeah, huge influence. Unlike Videodrome was a lot more sane. That was released in 1983, when everyone was obviously a bit more sensible, a little more Reagan. And that involves a TV channel that runs BDSM shows that cause hallucination, that become real, and then Debbie Harry is in it as some kind of weird sex bot. If you don't know who Debbie Harry is, ask your dad, probably when your mum's not in the room. You'll avoid a lot of very awkward questions. Main reason it's important here, other than the fact that you have the BDSM and the surrealism, and just the basic pure nihilism as it all for this genre, I had an awful lot of body horror, which you can recognise as showing up around here. Weird techno organic stuff. That's a TV that's just exploded and its literal guts have fallen out on the screen. It all makes sense in the movie, apparently. Yeah, lots of strange sex. Just to clarify, that's basically a vagina that the main character developed in his torso and someone putting a video cassette in it to play it. You think that's bad? That's Debbie Harry and he's fucking her mouth through a TV screen with his head, so. Yeah, it was strange. Anyway, this had a huge impact on Japan, and they made this. It tells the story of the metal fetishist taking over the lives of the salaryman and his girlfriend and turning them into metal mutants, and at the end you have a giant metal phallus that's the two male characters riding through Tokyo on what's possibly a motorbike, and I don't know. I've watched it a lot and I don't know. Examining text, sex, sexuality, salaryman life, it was, yeah, you saw the trailer. Curiously, it had a lot of, at the time it had a lot of taboos in it, homosexual and anti-sexual. It's not like non-sexual, it's just straightforward sex is bad and stuff going on. These included the salaryman killing his girlfriend after his penis turned into a metal drill bit and was screaming at death. And as I said, the salaryman and the metal fetishist forming a giant metaphallic flying off the end to destroy the world. Because you know, it's Friday, what are you going to do? It was an underground punk film. Which is very cheaply. The full credit list is wrong. The producer, director, story main artist was the person who played the metal fetishist. He convinced people he was making a nice project that'd be good for their CD and got them to turn up for maybe a day or two, and then they ran away screaming because fuck that shit. He's also seen by many as first and definitive work of the Japanese cyberpunk movement. Death Powder did come out before. Does anybody here know Death Powder? No, fine, right, we'll ignore everything I've said, it doesn't matter to you. There is a movie that came out before called Death Battle, which is not quite as refined. Anyway, to follow this one up, we have this. Therefore he's thrown out where he was living and they blanked his mind. He has no idea what's going on and all that happens in various orders. Fuck me, was it strange. Got lots of strange section here. This time with lesbians, yay! It's not as erotic as it sounds. Lots of broken reality going on. It also picks up on the big thing that's happening all the way through this with the previous stuff that was happening in Cyberpunk. It was all about, oh, the bureaucracy. Oh, the old strange. This time it was just metamorphosis and body horror and things just going very, very weird. Compared to Tetsuo, it was in colour. It also picked up an awful lot of stuff that was happening in the grunge movement that was growing up in the at the time. So it was the punks just basically going, what if we sang about love? Which was good. And it had a lot more positive, you're not going to believe me, it had a lot more positive and a lot more pleasant outcome than Tetsuo. And then to finish it off in the what's seen as the triumvirate of this genre, we have this. Rubber's Lover, the hardest pronounced Japanese movie ever, of the Japanese. By many people seen as a follow-up, both a follow-up and a prequel to 964 Pinocchio. If it makes anyone feel any better, everything in the trailer is a sex scene. You are never going to look at nurses in the same way again. It's fucking madness on the stick. That's pretty much self-explanatory, you saw all that going on. This is when the Japanese cyberpunk genre for me did carry on, but this is the final point before it just becomes gore and mayhem. If cyberpunk is sci-fi horror, this just turned into horror, and the sci-fi was basically there as an excuse at best. Has anybody here seen Tokyo Gore, please?
Yes.
Yeah. Was there any social commentary, or was it just women being very strange mutants? I'll take that as a yeah. So, this happened about 1996, and then following this up, we had a major incident, which was explained in the program. We had Neon Genesis Evangelion turning up. So yeah, we're going to discuss that very briefly. So here's the trailer. I have no idea what went wrong there. That was supposed to be the intro sequence. Thankfully, I have got a backup scene. I have got a backup. This is a scene from the movie. I think it was about mid-season. Hang on a moment.
Shinji, you must pilot the robot.
No, I'm afraid.
Shinji, you fucker!
If I pilot it, or I won't love you anymore.
Father, you never loved me!
I don't know what's going wrong. I'm pretty sure MSP Channel's absolutely literally fucked my PC. That this is an actual trailer to give people an idea of the cyberpunk awesomeness that allegedly was. Cyberpunk was really, really popular. I mean, Denzel Washington turned up in a cyberpunk movie that we don't talk about. That was how popular cyberpunk was at the time. And it was name-checked by a whole bunch of people who made a whole bunch of cyberpunk content. It had people fusing with machines. That's really cyberpunk, isn't it? No? Right,
yep.
Okay. It had sex and violence. Yeah. Had pen. It was a fucking augmented penguin. He had it was a half-borg penguin. That's pretty fucking cyberpunk.
Yeah, he's a sensible character.
Yeah, he was. He just hit the fucking hills. And it was marketed at the same audience. An awful lot of people in marketing went, this is cyberpunk. Yeah. Who here thinks I have opinions on this one? Here's why Neon Genesis Evangelion was not even slightly cyberpunk, no matter what idiots say. Right, deals with moody teenagers whining like bitches.
Yeah. So they do have terrible parents.
They have extremely terrible parents. That doesn't mean it's not Beverly Hills 90510 with Max. It's one person's allegorical story of their breakdown by a senti backlink character. Not in itself a bad thing. I'm just pointing out, if you can go do, instead of doing group therapy, you decide to do a story of robots punching angels in the mouth. Fine, if that works for you, it's great. And also random religious iconography. Who here thinks that the whole Christian cross thing in Evangelion was meaningful and deep and had any relevance to anything? Come on, be honest. Yeah, no. wrong. He literally just went, oh yeah, no one in Japan knows what this means. I'll throw it in randomly.
Except for the fact there's various Christian references because the organization they're working for is referencing the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Yes, and he threw it in because people wouldn't know it. He himself has said there's no religion, no meaning behind the angels.
Jesus
visited
Japan.
Say what?
Jesus visited Japan, didn't you know?
I'm not a Mormon like you, so I wouldn't know. And also my main argument against it is, whereas everything else asked important psychological questions, the main questions asked in this series... I'm just saying, these are pretty quick and easy questions, and they don't necessarily have a lot to do with man-machine interaction. So if you like it, that's cool, that's groovy, fill your boots. It's not Cyberpunk, get the hell over it.
Is it a fun thing?
No, I'm saying, if you like it, you like it. It's just don't come
to the question.
Answer the question.
No! Two. Just don't do it, alright? Anyway, so where did this leave it? So that was the end of the first wave. We had the first wave, we had the second wave, we then ended up with the third wave. This was like in the late 90s, where cyberpunk as a genre itself was going through a little bit of a crisis. Because, hell, we're in the 90s, the internet had happened. We were living in the cyberpunk future. Shit, how do we write about it when this happened? It was still asking questions, it had a greater interest in humanities philosophy. Basically, before it was asking lots of things about what would the technology do, and now it was asking about what is it to be human, which is pretty cool if you get down to it. Written after the internet, 90s cyberpunk boom, eventually the war on terror, that was obviously 2001, all had their effect. Basically, the cultural climate had massively shifted, which meant the cyberpunk, a very 80s genre, was now dealing with being 20 years old. And everyone knows what you do when you're dealing with the fact that you're getting old. You get a motorbike. No, hang on. It was going through a midlife crisis as a genre. You had an awful lot more difference. It was nowhere near as unified. The genres, since basically the end of the 2Ks, the genre has become an awful lot more bitty. It's become a lot more random and scattershot. You also have the curious situation where cyberpunk has become both a setting and a genre. You can end up in situations where you've got a completely cyberpunk world, but it is not cyberpunk. It's not asking the questions, it's not hitting the markers on it. It's just, yeah, we're in a world with BioWare and internets and all these neat tricks. And it's like, yeah, but you're just using an excuse to blow something the hell up. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with blowing stuff the hell up. I'm very much pro blowing things up. Anyway, one of the first big things of this wave was this.
Hello, Abby.
Hello, Lane.
It was suicide. She jumped off a building last night. The teacher told everyone. But if she's dead,
then it shouldn't be getting any emails from her.
Somehow. That's how societies are created. You can live and communicate in both worlds. Not be afraid of
them. I'm not scared. Not really.
We were partying, Lane. Out in Siberia last night. When we saw a girl who looked exactly like you.
But last night, I was...
Who in the hell are you?
I am me. I'm the only me, right? And there isn't any other me but me.
We need the communication. Don't ever get it confused with the real world.
You're wrong. The border between the two isn't so clear.
You have to remain rich a human being forever. Mankind has finally created an exit.
So it was Lane, came in 1998. Basically, dead kids sending emails, OVR, undiscussed themes, gets very strange. Huge number of references to real stuff. If anyone's not seen it, the people who wrote this were mental with their research and they tried to make the most realistic, unrealistic thing ever.
They're also massive Apple fanboys.
Say what?
They were massive Apple fanboys.
Yeah, let's not hold that against them, okay? I don't make these genres up. It was seen by many people as being now punk because it was basically supposed to be set in a contemporary Japan with an incredibly high-tech internet that allowed VR translations through that. Again, marketing came up with this word. Techno thriller to me is a perfectly acceptable phrase, but someone went, no, we've got to make it now punk because, you know, steampunk came along and then you had aeropunk. Does anybody actually know how many punks we've now got? We've got steampunk, which is basically slam a cog on it. We've got diesel punk, which is basically make it balloon.
Deco punk, which is very sort of 1950s.
Yeah, deco punk, yeah. It's cyberpunk where it looks pretty.
Actual punk, which is just shit right now.
Hardcore punk is still pretty fucking good. There's loads of stuff. The Dickies are getting back on tour. Shut up. fucking deal with it. I'll have you.
Border.
What?
Art Deco has never been pretty.
I'm not an aestheticist. Ask her. Anyone else? Anyone else for a shot?
Oh, right.
Following that up, 2001. It's one of the best films ever. Trust me. You had a pulse. Has anybody here seen it? Choice. Right. yeah, basically, it, ghosts turned up through social media and destroyed the planet. Yeah, but they started in 2001, and we still have that problem. It was seriously just straight up as a metaphor for social media and the communities and the growing issue. Oh, God. Hikikomori?
Hikikomori.
Okay, I don't have a drink on that one. It was seen by an awful lot of people as being a horror film. It was part of the big Japanese horror film boom going on. In my opinion, because it had a huge amount of techno terror, and it was talking about the position of the technology in mankind, I think it counts as cyberpunk. As I said earlier on, cyberpunk is essentially like sci-fi horror. If the tail end of the Japanese cyberpunk genre was sci-fi horror, I think this is looking at it from the other direction of a horror movie looking at sci-fi. So I think it still counts within the genre. If people want to work on that one, they want to shout out, they can go for it. I think it's pretty much within there. Also, now punk is set in the real Japan, but it's still got all things there. And it was good enough to get remade in America, and they actually remade it really well. Who here's seen Dark Water, the American version? How good was it? Who here saw The Ring, the American version? How good was it? Yeah. This is actually a good remake. It worked really, really well. So of pure novelty value, it's worth giving that a shot. And then they made a whole bunch of sequels, which you just don't need to fucking watch ever. They were terrible. Right. Following that, Ghost in the Shell turns up again, because this will never fucking die. It's as simple as that. So yeah, another reworking of it. The standalone complex ended up being two series, two movies, three books, two manga runs, two games. I'm sure there's 101 coasters, tea cozies, mugs, whatever. This time, for whatever reason, it just hit absolutely huge. It's pretty interesting because they really just rammed home the idea of the society. It also asks, you know, it was trying to create a realistic view of a really futuristic Japan. They were trying to take things a step forward, go, well, how is the tech going? How are things going to develop? They also ask the deeply important philosophical question, just how cute would sentient police tanks be? very, just to clarify, and I'm not going to give spoilers, but oh my God, yes, they are so cute, and they're wonderful, lovely things, and I wish I had one as a pet, and I wouldn't use it to kill people, honest. You also have it being, for a Japanese movie, it was very international in its outlook. It was looking at lots of other countries. I mean, half of them were fake because they didn't want to kick off major wars because they were worried a TV series would, but you know, that's not really going to happen. And then Trump got in, okay, TV series can kick off wars. It was a big metaphor for Japan trying to find its place within the world because they'd gone from being apologetic to being like, yeah, we're Japan. fuck it, we got a load of money, we got a big army, can we use it maybe now? No? Okay. The first series, it gave its concept to the Laughing Man, which the standalone complex, does everyone here know what the concept of the standalone complex is? Anybody not know? There's no shame in this one, I'm not going to grief you on this. It's basically the idea that like someone can come up with an idea and then the idea goes and gets its own life. So basically like mimetic theory and all that. So it really had a lot going on like the idea of thought and all that. Also curiously, Ghost in the Shell standalone complex Innocence 2, I believe it's titled, is the only film that will actually make you worried about whether a basset hound is real or not. It's a little bit of an open university lecture that will send you to sleep, but at the end of it, you all just go, but is that fucking dog a real dog or not? I have to know. Deep philosophical questions. And yeah, gave us Innocence 2, gave us Rise, and it also helped live action movie get made. If it wasn't for this, we wouldn't be having the prospect of Scarlett Johansson as the manager, which is fun. Then we had this happen. So that's the trailer for Ergo Proxy, which is actually quite worth a watch. Retreads the particular robot trope, this time post-environmental disaster Doom City. It's pretty difficult to go into the details without giving an awful lot away. One of the things it does do, as it hints on the trailer, is it actually... who here remembers the movie Equilibrium? Yeah. It does Equilibrium and not be shit. So it actually makes sense how everything works, which is quite a miracle. It also picked up an awful lot of tropes from Ian Flux. And had a lot of the horror going on. Ian Flux was a weird little movie done by MTV, series done by MTV in the late 80s, which was picking up on an awful lot of the cyberpunk going on in Japan and then trying to make an Americanized version. This then came along and turned up an awful lot of the plots that were happening in Ian Flux and just went, hey, let's do that again. So we got a lot of churn going on in the Pacific where Japan and America's swapping stories and half the time they're doing it through the medium of cyberpunk. It also, quite curiously, something no one's really touched on before within the genre, the Gnostic theory of what is truth, what is knowledge, how do we equate knowledge, which is pretty different and pretty exciting, especially for people who like deep arc of philosophy, which most cyberpunk fans need to be. And it basically did really, really well. It also got shown on Fuse TV as it was being aired in Japan, which doesn't sound like a huge achievement, but at the time that was actually quite a big thing. So it was a pretty good showing for the genre. And we then come on to the final decent bit of cyberpunk that's actually happened from Japan for the last...
isolated as latent criminals, but we allow them in the outside world for a single purpose, to flush out and hunt down criminals just like themselves. They're nothing more than hunting dogs. The best way to track a beast is with a beast. We call them enforcers. Each one of them is your subordinate. Let me tell you, all the time I've spent on this job, I have yet to encounter a single reasonable man.
Hold on, what are you planning to do now?
I'm going to stand next to this woman named Yuki Funahara, and I'm going to kill her.
Yay! So yeah, another police procedural. It was the police procedural was being picked up on all floor and the Cyberpunk was happening at the time. This one did it incredibly well. Lots of questions about social cohesion, free will, nature versus nurture, emotional repression. It was also seen by a lot of people as a critique of the cultural homogeny and emotional repression that was happening in Japan. As everyone here knows, they not exactly the most stable people. The heavy influence by, sorry, the big important thing was the people making it were that was heavily influenced by Gattaca, Minority Report, Blade Runner. So it's basically shows that they've been majorly influenced by the Japanese output, but now majorly influencing the Japanese output themselves. So we've got the complete cultural churn going on. And it was seriously highly acclaimed. It's sold out screenings of key episodes, nominated for the Cine Award, 4th Best Title of the Year at the New Type of Anime Awards, Best Episode of Nekotomi Award, 10th Anniversary Fan Vote, Anime New Network listed as the 5th most successful anime series for people who have not watched Japanese animation before. And it was a Cyberpunk series that was basically going, hey, look at this, we're accessible, and we're good for the stuff. And it's probably the last recent major massive output from Japan on the subject. So, if anyone's interested in Japanese cyberpunk and the content that it produced, there's Ghost Robots and Weird, sorry, Robot Ghosts and Weird Dreams by Christopher Bolton. It's a very good general history of Japanese sci-fi, going from the very start through the current era. You've got Fullmetal Apache, more of a cultural critique, supports the theory of the Great Pacific conversation going on between America and Japan through Cyberpunk. It's also got an awful lot about how Cyberpunk is a reflection of Japanese folklore, with the strange creature phenomenon going on in that. And then you've got Tokyo Cyberpunk, which focuses on the social, economic, and post Akira world Japanese sci fi. So that's what we've got so far. Has anybody got any questions or anything they want to say? Yo, the back!
Why do you think Cyberpunk as a genre seems to have stopped in anime and manga?
Because we're living in the cyberpunk world. In the 80s, it was incredibly cool to go, hey, what about if we had this computer network where you didn't have to have TV and you could just publish anything you want to say, and now we've got YouTube. And it's like the idea of, hey, wouldn't it be really cool if you could publish your own magazine, and now we've got Facebook. And we kind of like hacked the planet, and WikiLeaks happened, and everyone went, wow, that's really interesting to read in The Guardian and not do anything about. So yeah, diamonds are because it actually happened. Would be my big thesis. Any other questions? Search.
Just on that subject, it's got setting very exactly. I don't remember if it's asking any good questions.
If it's not asking questions, then no.
I'm not quite up to this, but I'm not sure quite.
It's the cyberpunk has to have that asking the question. It needs to be asking some kind of philosophical issue, otherwise it's the setting rather than the genre. Does anyone here have anything that they think I left out that should have been included as a major work? Or anything that... Yo!
From the New World.
I haven't seen it, I can't watch everything. I try.
Is that
set
radio?
Yeah, set radio.
Video game, not...
Definitely have the setting, but yeah, it's the thing is, if you've got the setting and it's just people going through the world and just existing within it, then that basically just becomes near future sci-fi. It's got to have the philosophical issues going on, otherwise it's just not really hitting. It doesn't have to necessarily hit very hard, it's just got to be asking something about how the technology interacts with the humans, otherwise it's just near future sci-fi. Which is not saying it's bad, it's just it's not cyberpunk, that's all. The single biggest thing Cyberpunk got wrong, beyond anything else, because they got so much right, like as we did last year, corporations like running militaries, all the technology happening, people having access to the world on their phone. The biggest thing that Cyberpunk ever got wrong was VR hacking. Because no one's ever going to hack through VR, because that bollocks is the world's worst interface ever. It looked brilliant in Johnny Mnemonic, but it's just utterly incredible. This is why now punk as a genre exists. As soon as hackers came out, if hackers had been made 3 years earlier, it would have been seen as a cyberpunk classic. It got made at a time when everyone was going on AOL. The genre existed in the 80s because it was a future idea. And then it hit the 90s and then suddenly everything turned up and it's struggling as a genre.
So what you're saying is the genre's biggest mistake was it gave itself a shelf life.
Yeah, it was a near future genre and it got it right. So as soon as you stop being fact and as soon as you stop being fiction and you become fact, you're no longer relevant as a fictional narrative device. And I'm saying this about the fucking genre I love. It's very hard to find good cyberpunk these days, which is why the third wave, the mind wave, was very bitty compared to the 80s, and a lot of it was relatively tangential. And back.
I was going to say, almost sort of tapping into what he was saying there about the fact that because it has sort of a lot of these connotations and associations with that sort of 1970s, 1980s vibe, cyberpunk now, to a degree, exists almost as an anachronism in the same way that steampunk exists as an anachronism?
Not so much as steampunk. I mean, steampunk was... I'm not going to shit on steampunk, but steampunk is, to a greater degree, it's a bunch of stuff that really got cobbled together by marketing. I mean, steampunk, when you look at the Jules Verne, that at the time was cutting edge sci-fi. And then a whole bunch of people went and looked at it, did like this retro thing. I would argue that the cyberpunk is a lot more relevant now than steampunk is, because steampunk is a future that didn't happen, whereas cyberpunk is a future that did.